This morning, you've made it through fasting and prayer. Of course, those that didn't make it, they're not here today, so we don't know. They have fallen by the wayside somewhere. This past week, because it was 2 weeks, I had begun in the evenings having just some vegetable broth or some vegetable soup or some things like that. But last night, I began to break my fast, and so after I'd had my vegetable broth, you know, I'd been blessed by so many of you with boxes of chocolates and boxes of cookies and all these things after Christmas, and I had set all of them aside because I thought, if I start eating them now, it will be so much in my mind and so much in my thoughts. And so I had set all of them aside. So last night after I had my vegetable broth, I thought, I think I can open one of those boxes. So I thought, well, I won't open candy. I'll open a box of cookies. So I opened a box of cookies and I ate one. I thought, oh, this is so good. And then I thought, I'm going to have one more. And I opened the second one, and about halfway through, I thought, oh, this is too much. Our physical parts really change, don't they, during fasting and prayer, and what we're hungry for. And praise the Lord for that. I think we need that, don't we? I think we need that. I want to read something to you, and this will, as we lead into what I believe the Lord has put on our heart, on my heart for today. As I was reading this week about fasting and prayer, I read something from John Piper. He is an American pastor and writer, very well known in the U.S., writes quite a lot and has quite a large voice to speak, especially to American churches. But I want to read to you something that he said, that he has written about fasting. And when I read it, it struck my heart. Even as I have been seeking the Lord, and as we have been seeking the Lord in fasting and in prayer, John Piper writes, many times we don't fast because we've lost our spiritual appetite. The absence of fasting is the measure of our contentment with the absence of Christ. If we don't feel strong desires for the manifestation of the glory of God, it is not because we have drunk deeply and are satisfied. This is the part that hit my heart. It is because we have nibbled so long at the table of the world. Our soul is stuffed with small things, and there is no room for the great. Ouch. And I thought to myself, Lord, even in fasting and prayer, even in this time of fasting and prayer, that still speaks to my heart. That speaks to my heart. Even as I have sought Him, I have realized, Lord, my spiritual hunger is not what it could be. It is not what it should be. And as we look this morning at Scripture, and as we look ahead at 2017, as pastors, we are going to encourage you, and we're going to lead you, and we are going to partner with you in making fasting and prayer times a greater part of our church life, our corporate church family life this year. Not just here at the beginning of the year, okay, great, we fasted, until next January again. Whew, I've done it. But we're going to encourage you, and the Lord has been speaking to my heart. I've been talking with Pastor Renee about it. We don't want to be legalistic. We don't want to force anybody to do anything, but we are praying and seeking the Lord about how we can lead you as a church, as godly leaders, into more regular, more frequent times of waiting on the Lord and submitting ourselves to Him through fasting and prayer, that He might create a greater hunger for Him, and that He might do in our lives what He wants to do. Amen? Amen. Amen. I know at the end of our fasting and prayer time, that's not very exciting to hear, right? We're at the end of it, we're thinking, I'm ready to eat. I'm ready to do some things. But God will help us. God will help us, and He will give us a hunger for Him as we set our hearts to seek Him. So, amen. We turn to the Word this morning. Pastor Renee, do I need to move this, or is this okay here?
You can keep it because you don't have a table.
Thank you. Thank you. I will.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's a lighthouse cup.
It's not the kitty cat cup, so. This week, as I have been preparing, I knew Pastor Renee was going to speak last week. I've been seeking the Lord just during our times of fasting and praying. Lord, what do you have for us as we come to the end of our fasting and our praying? And he's been working in my heart. And so we look this morning at going on from here. And you'll see as I keep on going into it that, in fact, the title for this could have been something else, but I think we'll leave it at this, going on from here. We stand here this morning at the end of our time of fasting and prayer. By the way, I'm going to be giving you a lot of scriptures, but I won't be reading all of them, so get your pens ready if you want to take notes or if you want to take pictures of the screen as we go through, or if you want to come back to the second service, I'll preach the same thing, almost the same thing again. But here we stand. We've come to the end of our fasting and prayer, but it strikes me that we're only 3 weeks into 2017. That's hard to believe, isn't it? This is only the third Sunday of 2017, and it already seems a long time, doesn't it? January 1 seems so long ago, doesn't it? It seems like, well, a month ago, or this, not even that. This is just our third Sunday. And so it seems to me that we are still at the beginning of this new year. We have come to our time of fasting, end of our fasting and prayer corporately as a preparation, and we're looking ahead into this new year. And so it seems to me something that we consider is what we do now. What is next? How do we go on from here? Do we kind of go back to life as normal, life as usual? In a way we do, don't we? Fasting and prayer for a long time, as we have done, it is different from our daily lives. It requires, it's a different schedule, it's a different speed of life, it's a different way of doing things. So are we just going to now go back to how we were before and just enjoy the blessings of our times of fasting and prayer? Or are we going to do something different from this Sunday forward as we go into 2017? And I want to challenge you this morning that if we look back in the Old Testament at a picture of the children of Israel in the wilderness getting ready to go into the land of promise, we are going to find a wonderful example for us as we prepare to keep on going into this new year. And I've prayed about it. I thought, Lord, is this really you? I want to be sure. I am sure. This is the word of the Lord for us this morning. And so if you have your Bibles and you want to open to Deuteronomy, it's going to be almost all in Deuteronomy this morning. And I think we'll look maybe at one other scripture outside, but pretty much it's Deuteronomy. You think, oh, Deuteronomy? Yep. Deuteronomy, Old Testament. So join with me this morning as we look at the children of Israel, and then I want us to think about what this means to your life and to my life this morning. How do we apply it to our lives? We come to Deuteronomy, and in the early chapters of Deuteronomy, Moses gathers the children of Israel together, and he gives them a short history lesson, and then he gives them a revision. Now, I'm American, and so when I came to Hong Kong and I first heard the word revision, I did not know what that meant. In America, we always say review. We never say revision. And then I'd say, oh, we have revision. I thought, what? What? Revision. What is revision? And then I soon found out, oh, revision is what you do, what Nat Nat does, and what Josh and David do just before they have their exams. Is that right? That's right. And it's what some of us do as well, right? We have revision. And so you know what happens? Moses gathers them, and actually he gives them revision before they go into the promised land. He goes through the things that they have gone through so that they are ready for what comes next. Now, guys that I just called your names, Nat, Nat, Josh, and David, that's what revision is when you're getting ready for tests, isn't it? You go through what you've gone through to get ready for what comes next, right? The test comes next. That's coming the next day or the next few days. And this is what Joshua does with the children of Israel. And there's something there for us this morning that will help us as we look at this example. So he gives them revision. He gives them a history lesson, and very strongly and very dramatically, he tells them after the history lesson, he tells them what is next, what is ahead. And what he says is this: we're going into this new land. It's a new place. You're going to have a new leader. They already know Moses is not going to be their leader. Joshua is going to be their new leader. It's a new land. It's a new place. It's a new way of doing things. It's a new way of living. But as they go into this new place, he makes a point that needs to be a point for our hearts this morning. And he says, as you go into this new land, this promised land, there will be people there that are not like you, and you are not like them. As you move into Canaan and as you conquer Canaan through the power of God, there are going to be nations around you that are like this, 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 and this. And he says to them, they are like that, but you are like this, and you are not to be like they are. You are not to be that like they are. And then he gives very, very strong teachings. And as we go through this, I want you to hold on to one verse this morning. It's in Deuteronomy 14:1. In fact, this was almost the title. Next slide. Deuteronomy 14:1. In the middle of all the teaching, I'd never really noticed this before. Moses says to the children of Israel, you are the children of the Lord your God. And so I say to you this morning, as we come to the end of fasting and prayer, and as we look ahead at 2017, how shall we live? What shall we do? What shall we not do? I say to you this morning from the Lord, you are the children of the Lord your God. You are the children of the Lord your God. You live in a world where there are many people who are not the children of the Lord your God. You work in places where you are surrounded by people who are not the children of the Lord your God. You are in classrooms with many who are not the children of the Lord your God. You may be surrounded by family members who are not the children of the Lord your God. But brothers and sisters, this morning, as you face 2017, all of us, we are the children of the Lord our God. And because of that, things must be different in our lives. They must be different in our lives. Fasting and prayer, as we have done these last 2 weeks, helps to reaffirm that in our hearts. It helps to highlight the difference between us and them. It helps to solidify and to reaffirm what we are and what we are not in a world that is not of God. You are the children of the Lord your God. For the children of Israel, this was their cornerstone. This was their foundation. This was their guide and their guard. And brothers and sisters, this morning, this also must be our foundation. It must be our guide. It must be our guard. That's one of the reasons we had this time of fasting and prayer, to work this into our hearts. Now, how did this work for them? And then, how does it work for us? Let's look at the next slide. Deuteronomy 7:1 and then Deuteronomy 9:1-3. We're not going to read it all, so look with me very quickly, but I want you to notice one thing this morning as we go into this. First of all, there are many nations. For the children of Israel, there were many nations before them, and the nations were larger and stronger than the children of Israel. And then in Deuteronomy 9:1-3, he says a little bit more. He says, you are going into nations. You're going to dispossess nations that are greater and stronger than you, with large cities that have walls up to the sky. The people are strong and tall. Anakites, those are the big ones. That's like Goliath, but a whole city of them, a whole tribe of them. Anakites. And you know about them, and you've heard it said, who can stand up against the Anakites? They were so big and powerful and strong that there were rumors about them, that there was gossip about them, and they were going into this land. Now, what does that say to them, and what does it say to us this morning? We see what it says to them, and this is what it means to you and to me this morning. Be prepared, brothers and sisters, as you go into this world, and as you go into 2017, this year, where you work, where you study, and what you do, you are in a minority. You are not the majority. You are not the most numerous. You are not the most popular. You are not the most influential. You are in a minority because this is a world that is full of those who are not the children of the Lord your God. In natural terms, in everyday terms, they will always be more influential and more powerful than you. They will always have more influence than you. Your strength, listen carefully this morning, it will never be in numbers or in majority. You got that? It will never be in numbers or in majority. Your strength will be in the Lord your God. It will be in the Lord your God. And you are children of the Lord your God. Look at the next slide. He adds to it. Now I've added to it in both of these places where Moses talks about how strong they are and how powerful they are as they're going, these others are as they're going into this land. He says this, and when the Lord your God has delivered them over to you and you have defeated them, and in this passage, he says, but be assured today that the Lord your God is the one who goes across ahead of you like a devouring fire. He will destroy them. He will subdue them before you. The lesson for them was that their strength was not in numbers, nor in power, nor the might of their arm. Their strength was in the Lord their God. And as you and I go into this year in 2017, I encourage you this morning, don't start fighting with people. Don't start trying to get the upper hand, and it's a struggle between you and them. That's in the flesh, and we'll never win in the flesh. We'll never win in the flesh. Your strength is in the Lord your God. It's in the Lord your God. And your victory this year, as you are in a world that is full of the enemy, if you will. And you understand what I'm saying. God loves them as well. But until they have been brought into a relationship with the Lord, they are not part of the Lord's family. And so your struggle as you go into this year, it's not flesh and blood. We know that. It's not flesh and blood. Your strength is in the Lord your God. So you keep your eyes on Him and you go in His strength. And that is one of the reasons we fast and pray. We fast and pray because when we are weak, then we are strong. And we are strong in our spiritual being, in our spiritual man. Are there battles that you have fought? Look back this last year. Are there battles that you have fought in your own strength? How many of you have? I have, and I failed miserably. It just made me mad and bitter and angry. I don't know about you, but I figure that's kind of how it works, isn't it? When we fight in our own strength. You gotta fight in the strength of the Lord, and He is your strength, and through Him you will win. So there's a lesson for us, but let's keep on going. Now, as they go into the land, so He tells this is what it's going to be like. Now He gives them some directions to as they go into the land, and I encourage you this morning because there's something here for us, but don't get scared because this is going to be pretty strong. Let's look at the next slide. Here's what He says to them as they go into the land. This is from Deuteronomy 7, part of verse 2 and part of verse 5. You go in, then you must, destroy them totally. Make no treaty with them. Show them no mercy. Break down their altars. Smash their sacred stones. Cut down their Asherah poles. That's what they, it was very ungodly, immoral worship in the new land that they were going into, all the nations of the world. And these Asherah poles were part of it. You will burn their idols in the fire, for you're a people holy to the Lord your God. Remember Deuteronomy 14:1? You are the children of the Lord your God. And what does it say? You are a people holy to the Lord your God. Now, this sounds pretty strong, doesn't it? And right now you and I are thinking, what does that mean for me? What does that mean for me? May I tell you something this morning? What I've put here is only the tip of the iceberg. If you read in Deuteronomy, God says even more than that about taking care of the enemy and about destroying it. He really does. There's much more than that. Do all of this. Now, how does this relate to you and to me today? Does this mean that after the service is over, you should form a march, a demonstration, and march to Wong Tai Sin Temple, you know, over there, and smash everything, knock things over, tear it down? Does this mean that you should walk down Nathan or go over to Central, through the Central District, where all of these, where the idols of luxury and excess are, with Fendi and Tiffany, and I don't even know all the names of those big fancy places or whatever. I know some of them. And you should walk through there and smash all those things, because that's the idol of excess of this world. Is that what you should do? Not unless you want Pastor Renee and me to come visit you in prison, in jail, in Hong Kong. That's not what this means. That's not what this means. Now, what does this mean then to you and to me this morning? And I hope you're getting it. This is the word of the Lord for us this morning. What does this mean to you and to me in this world? For them, this is what they had to do. For us, I believe this is the message. The message is this. For them, he says, completely destroy it, because if you don't, it is going to snare you. Okay, so hang on with me as we look at what this means for us. He said, if you don't do this, it's going to be a snare to you. Look at the next slide. Let's look at it. Do not follow other gods, the gods of the people around you. So this is the land they were going to. So they were going to be surrounded by this. Look at the next one. What does it say? You must destroy all the peoples of the Lord your God gives over to you. Now look at that. Do not look on them with pity, and do not serve their gods, for that will be a what? A snare to you. What does the word snare mean? What does it mean? It means a trap. Are traps easily seen, or are traps hidden? They're hidden. Traps are hidden. And so he says, it's not going to... Okay, let's go back to where we were, please. Slide five. Slide six. Okay. Okay. So... Okay. It will be a snare to you. So it's something that's hidden. It doesn't look bad in the beginning. It looks okay, doesn't it? That's how snares work. Snares don't look like traps, and they don't look like there's any danger there. That's why they're so successful. Don't look on them with pity. Do not serve their gods. You see, they're going in, and God says, you got to get rid of it all. Oh, but Lord, that's hard. But there are women and children there as well. Is that... It doesn't look dangerous, does it? But God said it will be a snare to you. And then the next verse, we look at the next one, 11:16. Be careful, or you will be, what's this word? Enticed. What does that tell you when you use that word? When that word is used, what does the word enticed mean? What does it suggest to you? It's appealing, isn't it? There's something there that's attractive. There's something there that you'll look at and you'll think, I like that. You'll see it and you'll think, I want that. You will not look at it and think, oh, awful, it's terrible, it will bring death into my life. No, you look at it and it pulls your heart. What is the lesson for you and for me as we look at this? What God said to them and how that applies to you and to me this morning is this. As we go into 2017, the things that are not part of being a child of the Lord your God, you and I are to have nothing to do with them. No compromise. No mixing. No, well, a little bit's okay. Well, we're just being friendly. Well, I'm just going to do it this once. They don't mean any harm. What God said to them and what He says to you and to me this morning as we go into 2017 is, if we go into this new year with that attitude, well, it's not bad. It's not really bad. It's just a little bit. You and I will be ensnared and enticed by it, and it will become a trap to us. And so the Lord our God says to us as we go into 2017, He says, you deal with it decisively. You take care of it. You don't compromise with it. You don't play around with it. You don't leave it a little place in your heart. You don't leave it a little place in your thoughts. You don't leave it a little place in the corner of your heart where nobody knows, but you know that it's there. It is something that is not for the child of the Lord your God. And God says, if we let it in, if we leave it there, if we cherish it, if we have it there, it will be a snare to us. It will trap us, and we don't think it will. But He wants us to make it in 2017. And so He says, you don't compromise. You don't mess with it. Look at the, Look at the next slide. Look at the next slide. And so He says, let's go a little bit further. He says, the images you are to burn in the fire, don't covet the silver and the gold. Do you know what? I can covet something that should not be part of my life, and you will never know it. Did you know that? That's because coveting has to do with my heart, deep inside, and you don't know what's in my heart. But I can look on it, I can think about it, I can entertain it in my thoughts, and it's there, and I'm coveting it. You know why He uses this for them? As they went into the land, God said, destroy everything. Now in Jericho, when you get into it and read more, you'll see more later, but God says, you destroy it all. He even says, in most of the cases, even the gold and the silver. And I think that speaks to us very strongly this morning. And let me speak to you from my heart this morning. As I was preparing yesterday and I came across that, I just felt like the Holy Spirit just gripped my heart, especially for this passage this morning. So I want to speak to you very straight this morning and very strong this morning. For the children of Israel, as they went into the new, into this promised land, what would be appealing to them, they didn't want idols. The children of Israel, it wasn't idols. They didn't want Asherah poles. Those things were not what was wouldn't be appealing to them. But there was gold and there was silver that covered the idols. And those things, when they looked at them, those things are wonderful. Those things are valuable. Those things are precious. Those things look good. Do you see what I'm saying? And God says through Moses, He says, don't covet it and don't take it for yourselves. You burn it. There's no compromise. You can't play with fire and not get burned. You'll be ensnared. You will be enticed by it. Now look at what He says next. Do not bring a detestable thing into your house, or you, like it, will be set apart for destruction. And you say, what does that mean? The Lord is going to destroy me? I don't think that's the point here for you and for me. God spoke to them in that way. But the message to you and to me is this, and this is what I felt the Holy Spirit speaking so strongly yesterday as I was preparing this. And I'm saying this because I love you this morning, and this is the word of God for you this morning, and it's the word of God for me as well. We are in danger, some of us, if we have not yet, but some of us have already. We have taken things of this world that are not of God for us, and you know it's not of God for you, and you've taken it into your heart. What does this say? They took it into their house. You know what that says to me? What that says to me is they took something that God said, that's not for you. That's not for the child of the Lord your God, and they brought it inside. They brought it close to themselves. And what that says to you and to me this morning is this. There are some of us that have done it or are thinking about it. There are things that God has drawn a line. We know it's gold and silver of the idols of this world, but we want it. It is appealing to us. It meets something in us. It touches our hearts. It touches our dreams. It touches an appetite for us. And we've taken it into our hearts. And we're cherishing it. And it is becoming part of our hearts and becoming part of our lives. And if we don't take care of it decisively, it will destroy us this year. It will rob you of the victory that God has for you in Him. It will rob you of the peace that God has for you as His child. It will rob you of the blessing that God wants to pour on you this year because you are His child and you love Him and you are walking in obedience with Him this year. Get it out of your heart if you've already put it there. Now, let me make another application this morning. Sometimes it may not be things, but I want it, I want it. Sometimes it is things that are not for the child of God, and it may have to do with wrong attitudes or wrong relationships or wrong ways of dealing with one another. And I say to you, this falls in the same category. I speak to you this morning in love, but I say to you, if you and I have an ungodly attitude in our hearts towards someone else, especially in the family of God, especially towards another brother or a sister. There's somebody in the church or outside of the church that you feel has wronged you in some way or hasn't said sorry or has stepped on your toes in some way, and you've been holding on to that hurt in your heart. You've been against them. Are you serious? We are children of the Lord our God. And we are holding on to these things in our hearts that have nothing to do with God. That's the way the world does it. You hurt me, I'm going to hurt you. I'm not going to speak to you. That's the way of the world. That's the way of the world. And I'm sorry if you think you're being awfully hard on us. Me too. I'm including myself in this. Brothers and sisters, I tell you this in love. I tell you this in love. If you have allowed that in your heart, and if it has found a place in your heart, it is time to do something about it before you go any further into 2017. You better take care of it. If not, it will destroy you. It will destroy me. It has no place if these things in our hearts and in our lives and in our dreams and in our affections and in our imaginations and in our attitudes, if they are not part of being a child of the Lord your God, get it out. Burn it in the fire. Don't let there be anything left in your life and in my life that would ensnare or entice in 2017. Amen? Amen. Now I want to skip over because I do want to get to this morning. And I don't want you to be afraid to take action. Some of you are afraid. It's so hard. How can I do this? The story of Deuteronomy are the words again and again when God says through Moses, "Don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid. I will help you conquer. I will help you overcome." If it's been in your heart, God will help you get it out if you want Him to. Now, as we come to a close, I want to encourage you with the blessings of obedience. And I want to encourage you with this, because I know what I just said to you this morning was the message of the Lord for you and for me today. I know that. Was it hard? It was hard. It was the message of the Lord because He loves you. It's the message from my mouth because I love you and I want you to make it. I don't want to 6 months from now have to be on my knees praying for you because these things filled your heart and you've walked away. I want to preach to you now in love that these things might not become a snare to us or entice us. Now, here, beloved, are the blessings of obeying. Go to slide 9, Joshing. Here are the promises of obedience. And very quickly, I'm going to give you the promises of obedience this morning. These promises of obedience are for the youngest Christian here and the oldest Christian here, the most mature and the least mature. This is God's promise to each of us this morning. And here are the four promises of obedience. There are many, many more than this, but here are the four, and now we're going to look at them as we come to a close this morning. Are you ready?
Yes.
Next slide. The promise of obedience, strength. Deuteronomy 11:8. Observe therefore all the commands I'm giving you today, so that you may have the strength to go in and take over the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess. Brothers and sisters, this morning, if you say, God, I am going to obey you this year. I'm going to do what you've told me to do. I'm going to burn the idols. I'm not going to covet the gold and the silver. This is not going to be in my heart. Let me tell you God's promise to you this morning. First is strength. It will be strength to live for God. It will be strength to conquer for God. It will be strength to be victorious for God. Oh, you and I, we feel so weak and tired, don't we, as we come to the end of our 2 weeks of fasting and prayer. Let me tell you, the promise of God is strength. Strength. Amen. Amen. The next one, let's look at this one. What's the next one? The second one is blessing. The second one is blessing. In obedience is blessing. So the first one, in obedience, is strength this year. And the second one is blessing. Do you want the blessing of the Lord to be poured out on your life this year? Oh, so do I. I really do. I want abundance of blessing. And I don't mean that in a greedy way like, bless me, Lord. I really mean the blessings of the Lord overflowing in my life. Guess what? If I choose to do what he says to do, and I'm going to obey, and I'm going to take care of these things, I am going to have the blessing of the Lord overflowing in my life. He says, look it again, here's the word obey. If you obey the commands I'm giving you today to love the Lord your God, serve him with all your heart, with all your soul, look at verse 14, then I will send rain on your land in its season, autumn and spring rains, so you may gather in your grain, new wine and oil. Verse 15, I will provide grass in the fields for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. Isn't that a beautiful picture of the blessing of the Lord? The blessing of the Lord. You will have what you need in this new year, and you will have more than what you need in this new year. As you obey and follow him, the blessings of the Lord will pour forth in your life. Let's look at the next one. So the first one is what? In obedience is strength. In number two, in obedience is blessing. In number three, victory. And I love this one because, oh boy, I am so tired of being defeated by the devil, aren't you? I'm so tired of being overcome. I am ready to overcome. And as I obey, here is the promise of the Lord to me. If you carefully observe the commands I'm giving you to follow, so forth and so on, then what does it say? Verse 23, then the Lord will drive out all these nations before you, and you will dispossess nations larger and stronger than you. Every place where you set your foot will be yours. Verse 25, no man will be able to stand against you. Brothers and sisters, if you determine, God, I'm going to obey you this year. I'm going to do in my heart what you have said for me to do. God is going to make you victorious. You are not going to be defeated this year. You are going to defeat this year. You are not going to be overcome, but you are going to be an overcomer. And look at this. You are going to be an overcomer in situations where you are in the minority. You are going to be victorious in situations where you are less powerful than those around you. And I'm not preaching the popular TV message that you understand what I'm saying, don't you? This is the promise of God this morning, this brothers and sisters. This is, and we know Proverbs 30, verse 5, God what? keeps every promise he makes. As God gave this promise to them, he gives it to you and to me this year. You will be victorious. There are areas of my life and there are situations, brothers and sisters, where I am so tired of getting a half victory or one step forward, two steps back. I am ready for a season and a year and a time of victory in my life, a victory in my life. And I don't know about you, but for me, much more often, it is not victory against others or over others. It is victory over me. You know what I mean? It's victory over things in my own life. And God promises there will be victory in that. So, in obedience, there is victory. In obedience, there is blessing. In obedience, there is strength. And then the last one, the promise of obedience, there is rest. These are the decrees. You're careful to follow them as you go into the land, as long as you live in the land. Look at verse 10. What does he say? And he will give you rest from all your enemies around you so that you will live in safety. So that you will live in safety. The promise of God as you obey him. Brothers and sisters, he is going to give a rest to your spirits. How often do you and I feel like the world is just like barking dogs around us, isn't it? Have you ever felt that way? It's just like, I really mean that. Just tearing at our souls and biting at our spirits. And you feel like, oh God, help me. Oh God, deliver me. The promise of the Lord this year, as you walk in obedience, step by step by step, is that he is going to give you rest. He's going to give you rest. Why, as we close this morning, why would the Lord do all of these things for you and for me, brothers and sisters? Because he loves us, because he loves us. And Jiaxing, go to the very last slide. The very last slide. Because we are the children of the Lord our God. We are the children of the Lord our God. This is why God will do what he promises he will do. And brothers and sisters, this is why you and I also, as we close in prayer this morning, this is why you and I also, we say, yes, Lord, because we are children of the Lord our God. So we're going to close this morning in prayer, and we're just going to commit to the Lord. I know that the Lord was speaking to you this morning about some specific things. He has certainly spoken to me. He has certainly spoken to me. And Lord, we come to you this morning. And Father, I've already come to you on behalf of myself as a pastor of this church. But Lord, I come to you this morning on behalf of the sheep of your pasture and the sheep over whom you have given Pastor Renee and me the responsibility. And Lord, I pray for them this morning, for every one of them. Lord, I pray that they would make the decisions that they need to make. Lord, I pray that if they have been coveting the gold and the silver of the idols of this world, and it has become a snare to them, or an enticement or a trap to them, Lord, I pray this morning, not just that you would deliver them from that, but Lord, that they would do what they have to do so that you will deliver them, so that you will deliver them. Lord, I pray in our hearts, Lord, may we tear out anything that is not lovely and is not like the child of the Lord our God. Lord, attitudes and bitterness and unforgiveness against our brothers and sisters and grudges. Lord, dreams and hopes we're holding on to, plans that we have that really, they're not part of you. And Lord, we know that, but we want it. It has enticed us. Lord, this morning we lay it down. We take it out and we say, God, I throw it in the fire. I throw it in the fire. I throw it in the fire. I want to obey you. I want to obey you. I want, as I obey, Lord, I want to receive your strength. I want to receive your blessing. Lord, I want to have victory in you. And oh Lord, I want your rest in my life. God, I do my part. And Lord, I know you're going to help me do my part. As we go into this new year in 2017, we are the children of the Lord our God, and we will be holy unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 God bless you this morning. I'm praying for you. If you need to do some more praying, don't wait. Take care of it today. Amen.